Hey guys, Tarot here, bringing you a 2v2. Today we are on Moscow Outskirts, the revised version, upcoming in a new patch, also playing the December Balance Preview 2.0. Without any further ado, we have Zarok as US Forces and Mr. Smith, man behind the mod, also as US Forces in the north. Fighting against them we'll have Frost as Austria and Thunder Hun as OKW. I'm not sure what they changed on this map, honestly. This building here is different, right? It used to be over here, so it's making it more symmetrical, like that one. In fact, yeah, and they've got hay bales in there, so more symmetrical cover on the fuel. Oh, this is opened up as well. That's new. Anyway, first engagement. Rifleman versus Fox Medias. It's a pretty well coordinated push here. Three echelons briefly ran in there. Had to disengage. We got a Kubel. We're going to put some pressure on, and we've actually got a very early mortar team from Mr. Smith. He's up against a sniper though. I'm not sure that mortar team's going to get much mileage. But as usual, North Moscow having a bit of trouble holding on to their cutoff. But that's mainly because of the Kubel pressure this time. Could be a wipe here on these rifles. Just need cover. Yeah, there they go. Rifleman down. Pop volley fire just a little bit too late. And that is a complete collapse for Zarok. Known for his Maxim play, not his USF play. Smith having a lot of trouble here. This early mortar team, not sure this is the right choice. He's also floating quite a lot.
A capture point is being overrun. Run
the hawk over here. Now, I'm not sure what his build order is. Also, he's a rock going for two rear echelon. Bit of a surprise. Smoke from the mortar team, allowing this rifle squad to come in from the side. Mortar team now going to work on the Grenadiers. Rifleman going to clear out that MG. MG, yeah, soft retreat briefly. I'm going to try to put pressure on the sniper. Yeah, I think this would have gone a lot more smoothly if Mr. Smith had made one more squad, but it looks like he wants to go for some pathfinders. And they are very strong against snipers. Be able to crit, you know, like a low health sniper model, very useful. Jamming the cap here in the smoke, but could end up getting wiped on retreat if he's not careful. I don't think it's likely. Looks like Zarok now pushing into the middle. May come in for a flank on the sniper. No. Yes. Shooting at it, hasn't landed a shot. There he goes. I find he's occupied though, trying to hold on to the cutoff.
We're losing a capture point.
Swapping squads. Ooh, that could be a wipe. And it is. So, one all for the wipes. One of the strengths of Pathfinders, I find they vet up quite quickly, and their vet one is bonus sight, unless it's changed, so it'll help you spot those machine guns. But yeah, look at how much easier this is now as a north base to come and rotate towards your cutoff. Looks like they've removed some fences there as well. Just a lot easier to get out to defend both your cutoff and your fuel, which is a nice change. I believe this is still going to be occupying two match slots. They're continuing on with their summer and winter variants, but at least it's not going to be an instant veto. Captain pushing forwards, runs into the machine gun. Oh! The mortar shell almost takes it out. Oh man, we got some S-mines there as well. Look at this, I didn't even notice this heavy cover over here before. Sniper picking a few models as well. Allies in a lot of trouble. So they pick up the Kugel there. But yeah, their fuel control has been rather poor. Here comes a half-track though. Got mechanized, and remember, Lux has a 45-second longer build time now. So it's going to be a while, even though it's in construction, before it actually hits the field. There's a half-track, a bit of time to get some damage done. Squad's coming in from the side, machine gun repositioning. Where's the A half track? Using smoke here to try and defuse these air spines. It's going to be a rough grenade into the smoke and the grenades. It's a little bit of damage.
Heavy truck waiting for deployment.
Yeah, you can really tell the difference in the Lux build time now. Here goes the incendiary grenade. Oh, that's going to take a Faust. Should be able to get away alright. And I think he'll be able to get away before the Lux arrives. And at least he's feeling really aggressive with the Lux. More air spines down here. Ross making good use of them. Oh! But there was a bit of cat and mouse going on here. Greedy escapes. Okay. Here comes the Lux. And actually, there's not that many vetted up squads here for Zarok. In fact, he doesn't have any vetted up rifles, so can't snare that yet. Bring his 50 cal out. That can do some damage to it when the armor-piercing rounds are equipped. Sniper doing 22 kills! That is a tremendous kill rate. Oh man, 23. It's just racking them up. Fortunately, you're gonna deploy behind enemy lines. Take out the ambulance. There's one thing that they are going to change. They're not going to be able to cap territories whilst they're landing. have it on good authority that it's going to be the in exchange. Or they're going to remove that. Things looking grim. Whoa! Looks goes down. Must be an anti-tank grenade with a bit of 50 cal and a half-track follow-up. The A half-track is stationary and the autocannon is on fire. It can actually penetrate the looks.
We lost an infantry unit. They got wiped out.
Oh my god, these Fallschirmjäger are Vet 2 already. This is insane. And yeah, I mean, you can see the damage to the buildings. Grenades, much less. I mean, that's... usually they'll be like half health of this building, that kind of grenade, but not anymore. So Mr. Smith has taken a pounding, but at least they've managed to defuse the looks. And it looks like now Zarok's making some good headway on the right. Also deploying some paratroopers, but from the airborne commander. I actually played this myself on stream recently, and the P-47s with their revised rocket targeting are much more worthwhile getting. So I'm looking forward to a demonstration of that. However, yeah, the cluster bombs are come down a lot more slowly now. Oh, we got a Greyhound for Mr. Smith. Quite late though, look at this, 6 CPs. I suppose it's at a timing where there are no other light vehicles on the field, but should be quite dangerously close to Frost's medium tank timing. Oh, he's ticked all three stages, so maybe he's going straight for tier 4. I was thinking there should be like a medium tank on the field very shortly, but it looks like that's not what he's going for. Well, we've actually got an Opal Blitz down here for Frost as well. The munitions cache. Looks like he wants to make use of these frag bombs and of course the Stuka strafing run. So the Allies have pretty much given up trying to control the left. With the path of least resistance. No machine gun upgrade though for Mr. Smith. So this Greyhound's having a bit of trouble killing. I'm gonna take a Faust there. Likewise, his paratroopers also haven't been upgraded. Oh my god, look at this. This is a crazy ward.
Hit the deck! A capture point is being overrun.
Oh, pretty good grenade there. More. Yeah, these, I see some men paratroopering it. Oh, these are from a beacon. He's making use of this beacon to reinforce his paratroopers on the front lines. Thunderhan also went for a battle group, so it's delayed his first medium armor. And in fact may just go straight for a walking Stuka. The reason why Mr. Smith didn't have much munitions, we saw him use a lot of smoke here in the early game. On his re-echelons he's also got sweepers. Oh, he's... Going for double Greyhounds. Oh my gosh. Well, this could be devastating to the enemy's infantry. Or straight to Panzerwerfer. That is a very unusual build. And that's really allowing these... Oh, there goes the squad. Allowing these light vehicles a lot of breathing room. Extending their life well beyond what would usually happen in a game. Like Mr. Smith using the ray tactics, giving just the bonus line of sight. Oh, this could be the end of his captain. Nope. He's using the ray tactics to cap over here one of the Greyhounds. Squad down, re-echelons. Greyhound, ready for action. So there's a lot of stuff concentrated in this area for the Axis. The Allies really need some indirect fire to deal with it. However, they don't have the Calliope or... Oh, this sniper gets two hit by the Greyhound there. Well, that's a nice pickup.
Our riflemen are now trained in long range tactics.
So they can, of course, go for the Scott, which is pretty good. In our team games, especially.
Crowds are sniffing around our asses. Tactical point being captured. Contact! German infantry standing by. Round ready.
Oh, Mr. Smith lost his paratroopers. Yeah, okay. Thought he lost one other unit. I was like, what? Which one was it? But yeah, he's using those beacons. And then he lost his paras. I don't think they were upgraded though, so it's not really a problem. If it hasn't revealed itself yet, I think this would be a prime target. Oh, misses. Packet connects. A Shrek there. Maybe a Faust from these Fallschirmjäger. Oh, Greyhound sticks around a bit too long, but three of an airstrike actually forces the retreat. It's the cluster bombs. And yeah, you can see how slowly they come in now. Quite easily dodged by Thunderhun, but he did have to forego his mission to try and kill the Greyhound. With their kitten, avoid those cluster bombs. Has he forgotten it? That he even has this Werfer? I don't understand what's going on here. Uh oh, could this be the end of the ambulance? One thing that I didn't know about our Fallschirmjäger is they actually have quite a lot of penetration on the FG-42, which is why they're so good against light vehicles, like Katyushas and whatnot. When they used to get popped behind enemy lines, it's because they've actually got better penetration than most other small arms. Long range with a barrage. Kills the ambulance. Got two other model kills as well. That was very long range for a Werfer. Not surprised to see that kind of scatter on it. Oshimega, Vet 4 already. Most of the units in this game are Vet 2. Oshimega's vetting up very, very quickly. This could be a wipe here. AT gun over here though. But that could also get wiped. Yep. Could be worried about a telemine.
Enemy forces are securing our territory.
Usually going for double greyhounds like this would be punished by, you know, a Panzer IV at this stage of the game. The Axis choosing not to go for any kind of medium armor, at least to this point. Greyhound doing quite a lot of capping with the ray tactics activated. It looks like this one's on the hunt for the Opal Blitz. Gets deactivated. Looks like he... don't know if he's spotted or not. Bit of ring around the rosy. AT gun moving up. Could be the end of one of the Greyhounds here. We've got a Grenadier squad here with the Faust threatening. Faust is going to connect. Second pack's walked its way over here now as well. Missing their attack grounds. That Greyhound's definitely gonna go down. The second Werfer barrage fired off. Only got one model kill though. He's actually got a second Opal Blitz. He needs one more Faust to finish the job. And a small arms actually ends up finishing the job. Big push here. Oh, and that could be dead Paris. No. Incendiary grenade forces the mass retreat there. Oh, we got a Jackson though. We got a pair of Shermans for Zarok as well. He's got enough munitions for two P-47 rockets, Trace. Thunderhun is now getting a Jagdpanzer 4. And Frost looks like he's going straight for the Tiger, perhaps. But yeah, I mean, from the strong start that the Axis had, you definitely wouldn't imagine this turnaround would happen. But it's just because neither of them went for medium armor, and that's allowed the lifespan of these light vehicles to just be so long. They've been on the field and effective for such a long period, whereas usually they would have been shut down close to 10 minutes ago. Gun the cluster bombs. So again, you know, you've even got time to get out of a trench and run out of the way. Shim's going forward, clear out one. So this Sherman could go down. Yet Rakitin gets the job done. Smoke slightly too slow. But the Axis are in real trouble, and they kind of have to fight on this left-hand side now, because that's where all of Dunham's tank structures are. Bring in some artillery, try and knock this out. Is that major artillery or what? Is that from the... yes, major artillery. Okay, Panzer perhaps going to kill the Greyhound here. Does. And they're calling in airborne assault. Remember, this now similar to Stuka close to air support. In come all the planes. And they're best to try and kill these squads. Looks like they're going to take down the anti-tank gun. Jackson has left the area. I guess they're coming through now to target it. No. Oh, and we've got the pinning strafe on Frost. Whoa! How did this go down? Jagdpanzer just taking a weird path to retreat, runs into two anti-tank guns, goes down. Here is the big boy, the Tiger. In comes the P-47s, let's see how these go. They're about a quarter of the Tiger's health. The rear armor ones do really well, so one strafe, about half of the Tiger's health. So yeah, finally worth their investment now. More expensive than Stu Close air support, but might even be slightly better now. A lot of planes flying around. I think that's the upgraded major recon flight. Oh, Pathfinders. I'll live to fight another day. Well, the Allies may seem to have got themselves back into this game in terms of army size, but in terms of VPs, they're very far behind still. Oh, that was a much better whiff of barrage. Takes out the ambulance, gets a few mortal kills. Got to vet too, is that where it gets us? Yeah, barrage recharge bonus. It's going to be even more lethal now. Tiger ready to go. This rock still has enough for another P-47. It's actually cooled down already, quite a fast cooldown time on that. Oh, Falchionator being deployed. That could go quite poorly for them. And they go down. Careful where you drop your Falchionator. Double Rakitans moving forwards. These paratroopers are tearing into them. These double E1919s are expensive, but they do pack quite a punch. Another P-47 coming in. Tiger on the move this time. Looks like it didn't take very much damage. That strafe was from the first one that didn't actually do a pass on its first run. Oh, nasty mortar shell. Oh, and he drops the LMG as well. He probably go and pick them up more than the paratroopers, I would guess. They can fire LMGs on the move. Series 6 VPs left for the Allies.
We're getting the hell beat out of us. We got 75 points remaining.
Nice attempt on the bundle grenade in the retreat path, but these could be... Oh no, one of the Sherman's actually on armor piercing rounds. Let's see, high explosive. I think that allows the Falchionier to escape. Where are these kittens at? Okay, they're moving over now, but they were on the left. Huge grenade! Oh no! Panzerwerfer in the range of the anti-tank gun gets taken down. Frost actually went for a third Opal Blitz, I didn't even realize that. You're really greedy with those Opal Blitz trucks. Remember, they don't give resources to your allies anymore. I haven't for quite a while.
Okay, ready yourself.
What the hell am I missing? Green as green can be.
Anyways, I've got two VPs secured. It looks like Zorok going for another tank. Mr. Smith actually has a pretty decent sized army, so they're actually ahead in army size now. And as I said, because of all of these OKW trucks over here, they kind of have to push into this area to secure fuel, because trying to cap over here is quite risky. With like 3 HE Shermans, you very likely to lose any squad you send over there. So you have to consider. Greyhound's gonna go down there.
Light vehicle just got destroyed.
Jackson could be in trouble here as well. Picks a Faust. Sherman's coming in from the side where those Rakitans. Comes the airborne assault. All sorts of artillery dropping down those. Sherman's going for a rather heroic push. Also got the strafing run loiter going as well. Once again, these Rakitans not in the right position for Thunderhun. Might have been able to snipe one of these Shermans if they're better positioned. Yeah, and the way that this one works is machine gun planes come down first, and then on this, like, essentially on the second pass, that's when the anti-tank planes come down. And then it does two passes of the anti-tank planes. So yeah, you kind of have to activate this quite early if you actually want the anti-tank planes to hit a tank. It does not have the machine gun upgrade, very curiously. That'll be the first thing I would do. Another Greyhound! Oh, and he gets a wipe. Tiger looks ready to make a push forward. Remember, Tiger now has a better movement. Oh yeah, see, this is what I'm talking about. You can't send squads over there with three Shermans. Just can't even contest it. Just need to make a more coordinated push on the left. Now I've got the paratroopers though, that's a nice pickup. I've also the armor piercing rounds there doing crazy damage, and the Sherman lucky penetrating the frontal armor of the Tiger. Tiger was likely to go down to the Sherman, I mean to the Jackson anyway, but really rubbing salt in the wounds. Trying to use attack ground, probably doesn't have sight through the hedge. Could get the Jackson here. Oh, doesn't quite target it in time. Oh, how is that Sherman not dead? Oh, and the Jackson too. That unusual amount of health to start off with. Anyway, these other Shermans are going on a rampage over here. Frost actually building two Stugs now. Greyhound gets abandoned, and Mr. Smith has actually lost almost all of his infantry. So, he's not in the best position. These flak emplacements can actually be quite difficult to kill. And quite quick to appear as well. Enemy movement! On the flank! Commander! Get down! It's good use of the trench though. Really nice position for it, overlooking the central VP.
Push your attack! They are down to 50 points!
Here we've got double Stugs now. Can they take out this mass of Shermans from the Allies? Also need some mines. The problem with needing mines is that they need map control to put mines in good positions, and they just don't have that right now. Could probably put some down here. Looks like they've got one shoe mine down. Probably do a couple more. Here come the Shermans. Rakitin in a much better position now, but misses its... oh no, connects. He's cleared out so quickly. All these Shermans going crazy. Come frag bombs, hoping to stun one of them. Does stun one of them, that could be the end of it. And is. Double Stugs now on the chase. Sherman's popping smoke. Double Stugs gonna chase through the smoke, very risky. No, they abandoned that idea. One thing that I didn't actually talk about before was the Jackson. Oh. High velocity arm piercing rounds at the moment are still doing 240 damage per hit. That's actually getting changed to 200. So it's kind of similar to how it was before. It's a 40 damage bump over the regular shot, which is now going to 160 instead of being 80 damage bonus, which I think is fair with the new added durability off the Jackson. Yeah, I got my window open. I don't know if you can hear those car noises, but there's summer here. So yeah, having the window open is a must. Stroke taking in a few hits there. Allies very long VPs though, 40. You know, they seem to be kind of incrementally getting better and better, and it looks like they're a bit late to react to these bombs. But that's going to be the end of the Sherman. He runs into his own cluster bombs and goes down. Even come the P-47s. Got an anti-tank gun here as well. Definitely one of these Stugs is going to go down. second plane. Assuming it's coming in from the side. There goes the second Stug. Can they take down these Shermans? Get some revenge on... One of them goes down. Smoke. Trying to cover the retreat of the other one. And I think it'll get away. This pack is... You know, if it was in a slightly better position there, it might have been able to... contribute a bit more. So, two Stugs for one Sherman. Also the activation of this ability. But the allies do seem to have a bigger munitions flow. Uh-oh, paratroopers forgotten about. Mistake there by Zarok. Too busy trying to micro his vehicles. Jeez! Now the allies are starting to get the Scots. Trying to get a bit of indirect fire going. Scots and Jacksons with some 50 cal support are quite strong in team games. Oh! And there's the King Tiger for Thunderhun. Could this be the turning point for the Axis Frosts? Got one Stug. They've got a vet up pack, but that's over here on this side. Doesn't look like it's going to contribute in the coming fight. Two other anti-tank guns. Cluster bombs coming down here. It's again hitting nothing. The delay to these is really quite. Oh no! Lieutenant one shot there by the King Tiger. They did increase the scatter on this, but it decreased the AoE. The King Tiger still one shot squads like crazy. It's just, it might take one more shot to actually get the one shot. Push the attack. They are down to 10 points left for the allies. Need to make something happen right now. Thunder, I mean, Zarok just has nothing, and Mr. Smith also in a bit of trouble. Just doesn't have any infantry. His vehicles are sitting back here doing nothing. Got so few VPs left. Once again, the swarm of Shermans is going in. But I think he needs one more Sherman. King Tiger's just too strong. And that's it. They just couldn't make the push there. I think he maybe forgot about these Scots. I'm not sure what happened there, but really need to make that push there. Might not have been able to do it anyway with all that elite infantry, but certainly the Scots would have helped. And yeah, they bit of anticlimactic end, honestly. Just ran too low on VPs. I felt like they were on the edge of making a comeback there, but if they also overinvested in Scots. Well, that was a pretty fun game. We got to see, you know, quite a few revised commander abilities. So, I'll wrap on that, guys. If you like your game to be cast by me, details in the video description below. Otherwise, I'll catch you all for the next thrilling installment. Goodbye, and good luck.